All of God's people said amen. My God is real. And I can feel it in my soul. I want to welcome all of those who are visiting with us. If you have come, we look at you as an honored guest. We don't take your visit lightly. Certainly we appreciate you coming by to hear what thus said the Lord. And as always, we look at you as being a blessing to us because God has sent you our way. We know that we can be a blessing to you, but we know that you are also a blessing to us. Amen. It tells us that God has remembered us and has put us on somebody's mind. Amen. We had a wonderful planning meeting for the church calendar and the budget, and we just want to let you know that we had a very productive meeting, started on time, ended on time, and that's always a good sign of production. It means that we didn't waste any time. We spent our time doing what we had allotted our time to do. Amen?
Amen.
Now, if you have not gotten your events on the calendar, it's not too late. There's still time to do that also. We're planning to have a church meeting in probably December to let you know what we are planning for the next year. Those things that we have put on the calendar are basically on the calendar. We have to get them off the calendar and put them into active use because we're not just trying to fill up a calendar. Amen?
Amen.
We're trying to do things that are productive and helpful to the congregation and for the furtherance of the gospel. Therefore, we need your hands, we need your hearts, we need your help, we need your pocketbook. We need your feet, and we need your voice in order for the calendar to be of any use at all. Otherwise, it's just a piece of paper that can be crumbled up, thrown into the garbage can, and repeated next year, crumbled up, thrown into the garbage can. But that's not what we want. Now, y'all are looking at me like I'm strange. I'm just trying to tell you that putting things on paper don't mean anything if the people don't get it off the paper and put it into practice.
Amen.
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 So we are looking forward to next year. Can you believe already it's November?
Yes.
Beautiful November Sunday morning. Amen.
Amen.
November the 3rd.
Yes.
I'm going to get to my sermon in a minute, but if you don't mind, I need to do that housekeeping stuff. Amen. If you can. Now if you can open up your Bibles to Colossians chapter 1. The verses are 1 through 5. When you get there, say amen.
Amen.
The Bible says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, and Timotheus, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ, which are at Colossae. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God and to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which you have to all the saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, wherefore you heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel. Faith, hope, and love,
yes. Yes.
The power of the gospel.
Amen.
Y'all got time?
Yes.
As Paul continues his greeting, he gratefully makes reference to a familiar trio: faith, hope, and love. But he places hope last. We always thank God, he said, for the love that you have, for the faith that you have. But we also want to thank God for the hope that you have. Anybody got any hope? Faith, hope, and love is always mentioned in the Bible, and it's mentioned several times in Scripture. It's sort of an apostolic shorthand, if you will, for genuine Christianity. None of these qualities can be manufactured by man. I say that again. It's an apostolic shorthand for genuine Christianity, none of which can be manufactured by man. They all come from God. In fact, the whole book of Colossians is dealing with the fact of man trying to manufacture. Are y'all still out there? Trying to make their own way toward God. They had some ceremonialism in Colossians. Are y'all still there? Strict rules about the kind of permissible foods and drinks that you can have in religious festivals. Ceremonialism. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Sometimes we get caught up in ceremony and forget all about the Christ. Sometimes we get caught up in you can't do this and you can't do that and you ought to do this and you ought to do that and you got to do it just right. You can't sing this song and you can't preach that way. Somebody ought to say amen if you can. You can't wear these kind of clothes. You can't do this. You can't do that. Ceremonialism. Right. Trying to fix ourselves with God on our own terms. That's ceremonialism. And then these folk in Colossae also practice asceticism, rules that Paul summarized as don't handle it, don't taste it, or don't touch it. Are y'all still out there? Asceticism is the kind of thing where you say, well, you know, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't taste that, you can't touch that, you can't handle that, because if you do this or do that, then it's going to mess up your relationship with God because you are setting your own terms. Sometimes we do that in the church. We look at folk and we say, they ought to be doing this because I liked it done that way. Somebody need to help me this morning. Y'all may not know what I'm talking about. Ceremonialism and asceticism. Don't touch, don't taste, don't do that. In fact, over in Romans, that's the whole problem that Paul is dealing with when folks say, you can't eat meat that's offered to idols. And Paul said, there's no such thing as idols. But you can't handle it, you can't touch it, and you can't taste it. Say amen if you can. Getting caught up in rituals that God don't even care about. Yes. Somebody need to help me this morning. I'm going to get there in a minute. I'm talking about faith, love, and hope. But I got to set some things in so that you can understand why Paul is telling the Colossians that he has remembered them ever since he's heard about their faith and their love and their hope. He's dealing with folk who are living in a region where folk are caught up in this ceremonialism. Yes. Yes. Amen. We got such a big problem right now in the church about hand clapping and all this stuff and foot stomping and different things about that, getting caught up on stuff that God ain't even concerned about. Let me move on. Amen. Because some of y'all feeling that way right now. But Lodge, we can't do that kind of stuff. Well, you need to just realize what God wants and not what you want. I know that, Paul was dealing with the weaker brother, but how long y'all going to stay weak? See, he didn't say leave them weak. He said there are some weak folk. But he didn't say leave them there. He said bring them from where they are. Work with them while they're weak and help their muscles to grow so that they can be stronger. But you don't have to leave them there. Somebody ought to help me. You know, if I had a physical therapist who came in, looked at me laying in the bed all weak and everything and said, well, you look good down there. Just stay there the way you are. No, it's going to hurt. It might be painful, but I want to get out of this bed. I don't want to stay weak all my life. I don't want to be where I am for the rest of my life. I need to be able to get up and move, and I want to be strong enough to deal with the stuff that life is going to throw at me. And sometimes, folks, that's going to be painful. Ceremonialism, asceticism, and you know, not only that, they would put angels above Christ. They were worshiping angels too. They were caught up on angelic beings and saying that they were divine ones who gave them all that they had because they were worshiping these angels. And Paul has to set them straight. Colossians chapter 2 and verse number 18, I don't have time to deal with that, but I'm just showing you some of the things that were going on and why Paul is talking about this faith, love, and hope, because these folk were messed up by all the stuff that was going on around them. They depreciated Christ also. Paul stressed that Christ is supreme in Colossians chapter 1 verses 15 through 20 against those who taught Christ was on the same level with angels. Christ is not an angel. In fact, Christ is not even on the same level with the devil, because the devil is an angel. And you don't have to try and put Christ on the same level with the devil. The devil has no comparison to Christ. And y'all need to stop giving the devil so much credit. I say you need to stop giving the devil so much credit. You need to stop giving the devil so much credit, because you keep talking about the devil made you do it. The devil didn't make you do nothing. You did it because you wanted to do it. Devil get blamed for everything. You mess up, the devil gets blamed for it. I had a little niece, and well, I got a little niece. She's not little anymore, but when she was younger, I was here in St. Louis, and she did something at home, and my niece, she's my great niece, and my niece asked her who did it, and she said, Uncle Gary did it. Uncle Gary wasn't nowhere around. That's the way it is. You do sometime when the devil, you say, the devil caused me to do it. The devil made me do it. The devil didn't make you do nothing. Amen. Your own lust and your entice made you do it. Go ahead on, fess up. Own it. You did it. Amen. If you can. Ceremonialism, asceticism, angel worship, depreciation of Christ. And then they had the audacity to say that you had to have some secret knowledge. Amen. Colossians chapter 2, verses 3 and 8. They said you got to have some. Look at that. I got to read that to you. Colossians chapter 2 and verses 3. They said you got to have some kind of secret knowledge. In verse number 3, the Bible says, and in whom are hid all treasures of wisdom and knowledge. He said, now, if you want some secret knowledge, you need to get in Christ, because everything is hid in him. And then drop down to verse number 8, and he said, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophies and vain deceit, after the traditions of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. Stop looking for some secret knowledge and stuff. Some folk want to know everything and don't know nothing. Somebody need to help me this morning. So there's secret knowledge, and salvation is not required by you having some secret knowledge. All you need to do is have faith in Christ. Amen. Amen. You got to know any mysteries and some secret handshake. Amen. Tap three times. Know the other half of the code. Can y'all help me this morning? But the most pressing thing that Paul has to deal with the Colossian church is the reliance on human wisdom and tradition. They were relying on human wisdom and tradition. These elements seem to be drawn from the extremes of Judaism. They were going back, and that's why he talks about handle not, touch not, and taste not. Because if a dead body had, they could not touch a dead body if it had been without getting themselves cleansed. They could not touch a woman who had an issue without being cleansed. And they could not touch all these things. And they had all this coming out of Hebrewism and all of Judaism and the ceremonialism. Paul is saying you are free from all that stuff. Yes. Have to worry about eating certain meats. You can eat whatever you want to eat. Say amen if you can. Amen. Within moderation. Now, I'm not trying to make you a vegan. I'm not trying to make you a carnivore. I'm trying to just tell you that you can eat whatever you want to eat with moderation. Say amen if you can. Faith. Faith. It all comes by faith. Y'all still there? Faith The gospel truth is received by faith. It's not by your secret knowledge. It's not because you are part of a special club. And we need to stop treating the church like that too. I say we need to stop treating the church as if it's some kind of special club that nobody else can get into. Amen? Let me move on. Let me define faith for you while I go there. Amen. You know, the word in Greek is pistis, and pistis means to be persuaded that something is true or to trust in something. It's far more than mere intellectual assent. It's more than just getting knowledge, because you can get knowledge and still not have faith in it. Amen? You know, sometimes the more you know, the less faith you have in it. Say amen if you can. If some of you really understood how your car worked, you probably wouldn't even want to ride it. You mean to tell me I'm sitting on something that has explosions going on in it every second? Amen. Yes, there are explosions going on in your car every second. And now that you know that, you may want to rethink it. You mean to tell me I'm riding in something that has the ability to explode at any particular time while I'm riding in it because I'm carrying around a whole tank of gas? Amen. The more you know, it might make you want to ride in it. Say amen if you can. You mean to tell me that the glow plug can actually send a spark through the motor and make it explode? Yes, it can. So the more you know may not make you really want to have faith in it. So faith is more than just having an assessment of knowledge and gaining great knowledge about something. Because the more you know, it may cause you not to want to know anymore. Amen, if you can. If you really knew that penicillin came from mold. Amen, if you can. If you really knew that there were bacteria crawling all over your body all the time that were good for you. Some of y'all just scratching right now. You really want to know that. Amen. If you really knew that most of the dust in your house comes from the dead skin off your body. But Lord, will you just move on, brother? I don't want to know all that. See, knowledge is not all just having great knowledge. No, I had faith that that dust was just from something that came from outside. Now I know it's me that's causing dust. See, amen, if you can. It's far more than intellectual answer. It involves obedience. John chapter 3 and verse number 36, the Bible says, he that believe in the Son has everlasting life, and he that believe in the Son shall not, and he that does not believe in the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abide with him. Faith is more than just having knowledge. It's about being obedient to what you know. Say amen if you can. Faith is more than just knowing. It's about doing. Acts chapter 6 and verse number 7, the Bible says, and the word of God increased, and the number of the disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly, and a great company of the priests were obedient to the faith. Yes. Yes. See, when you get it, you got to do something with it. Yeah. You just not come into church and come into church and come into church and... going home. It's about doing something with it. Romans chapter 15 and verse number 18 says, for I will not dare to speak of any of those things which Christ has wrought by me to make the Gentiles obedient by word and deed. Some of us talk a good game, but we don't do nothing. We always got all the answers, but we don't do nothing. Somebody need to help me this morning. Some folk can talk, and know all the answers and know all the things to do right, but don't do nothing. Amen. In 2020, we need more walkers than talkers. Somebody need to help me this morning. You see, you just can't have the knowledge and don't do anything for it. So some folk will tell you all the ways to do everything that you're trying to do and always got a better way, but don't have no. involvement in actually doing it. Say amen if you can. You know, some of you married folk know what I'm talking about. Not that I'm trying to get you in trouble with your wife, nor with my wife. But wives always have a honey-do list. They always know what needs to be done or you need to do. Amen?
Amen.
And they know how you ought to do it. But they ain't going to do it. Because that's for you to do. There are some folk in the church like that. Somebody, I need to move on. Say amen if you can. Let me see if I can build up on this faith. Let me see if I can expand it a little bit. Faith, according to the Hebrew writer over in Hebrews chapter 1 and Hebrews chapter 11, rather, in verse number 1, the Hebrew writer says, faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's not only that, it's the evidence of things not seen. It's the invisible backing of the elders when the elders needed something to stand on, something to back them and to keep them going. It was the invisible backing of them. It kept them moving forward, because when you have faith, you can keep on going no matter what comes against you. It's the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. It's that invisible backing. It's that thing that's behind you that keep you moving forward and not backwards. It's that creative power of the divine work of God. In verse number 3, it's the divine testimony of right doing. It's the divine testimony of right doing. It's the divine testimony of righteousness, doing what's right when you know there are things out there that you could be doing that's wrong. That's what faith does for you. Not only that, it's the cancellation of all natural laws. When you're thinking about faith, you know, folk are always looking for a miracle. Amen. Not realizing that the miracle has already happened in their lives. God has already stood you up, stabilized you, strengthened you, continuing to help you to make one step at a time. That's a miracle within itself, because in your mind you didn't want to move. You don't know how you came to be where you are, but faith brought you by a long, long ways. And that's why I trust in God, because God keep me moving even when I don't want to move. God keep me going when everything against me says I ought to sit down and never get back up again. It's the cancellation of those natural laws. It's based on pleasing God and not man. See, faith pleases God. Doesn't worry about what man says, because man has all kinds of opinions and all kinds of things that they want you to do, but it has nothing to do with what God wants. So faith is about pleasing God and not man. The Bible says it's impossible to please God without faith. Somebody need to help me. It depends upon God's word and not on man's word, because man will tell you anything. Girlfriend will tell you anything. Girlfriend always got all the answers. You know, that's why she always can tell you how to deal with your man. Amen. And she ain't got no man. Amen, if you can. A boyfriend at the barber shop can always tell you how to deal with that old woman. Amen. And he ain't got no old woman. Y'all with me this morning? Based on pleasing God, and it depends on God's word and not man's word, is trust in the unknown future. You know, I don't know what the future holds, but I know who holds the future. I don't know what's going to happen on tomorrow, but I know who already got tomorrow in control. Somebody ought to say, man, I don't know what the tomorrow may hold. But I don't know if I'm going to get up in the morning, but you know what? It doesn't matter if I don't get up in the morning. I know where I'm going to wake up. When it's all over, I'm going to be up there with God and the angels. So if I don't get up, I know where I'm going to wake up. It's counting things that be not as if there are things that are already. The Hebrew writer says in verse 11, chapter 11, verses 12, 11 and 12. Y'all still out there? It's seeing invisible things. You know, sometimes you walk in this earth and you're wondering what's going on all around you. I don't know. I've never seen an angel to my knowledge, but I believe that angels exist, because I believe that God exists. I believe that the devil exists because I believe that God exists. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins, rose on the third day, went back to heaven and prepared a place for me. And I believe he's coming back to get me. Seeing those invisible things. I can see my room right now. I know y'all saying I can see my mansion. It's just a room for me. I don't need a whole lot. I just need a place to lay my head, prop my feet. Say amen if you can. And some place to eat. Don't need much. I'm not looking for a mansion. I just want a room. Somebody else say amen. And if my room in heaven is anything like I expect it to be, it's going to be better than the prettiest mansion down here on earth. Faith is the assurance of God's faithfulness. God said that he's going to do it. I believe it. And if I don't believe it, it's still going to be. Somebody need to help me. It's confidence in those things to come. He said he's coming back. Said he left on a cloud. He's coming back on a cloud. Amen. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and then those who are alive shall be caught up with him to be forevermore. I don't know. I believe in that stuff just like it said it because I have faith. I'm not going to be like little dog Rover, dead all over. I'm going home one day. Somebody need to help me. It's confidence in those things to come. Stimuli for the Christian faith. It helps me. It's the lifeblood of the just. Nobody that say that they are just can live without faith. Say amen. You know, I know that the Bible teaches me vengeance is mine, said the Lord. And that helps me to be just because I can just leave it to God. Amen. I don't have to get vengeance on somebody. So I can always be just because I'm just leaving it up to God. I don't have to deal with every issue that somebody throw at me. I don't have to go back and get somebody back for everything that they do to me because I can just leave it up to God. That helps me to be just. Because I know justice is in God's hand and not mine. If I try and be just to you, I'm going to mess it up. I know I am. Because my justice doesn't have any mercy. Amen. Doesn't always have forgiveness. Doesn't always have let it go. My justice always wants you to suffer just as much as I suffered. So when I need to have justice, I need to just leave it up to God to deal with you. Because you're not going to get away from God. I remember Jonah. Jonah tried to run from God. Jonah tried to run ahead of God. And Jonah ended up running back to God. Somebody help me out. You know, you can't run from God. Justice, just leave it up to God. Over in Ephesians, faith is the armor, the Christian armor. You know, when things are being thrown at me, I just have to wrap myself in my faith. Amen. Don't have enough money to pay the bills? Wrap myself in faith. Friends turn against me, wrap myself in faith. Yes. Family turn against me, wrap myself in faith. Yes. Amen. Boss man not acting right, wrap myself in faith. Co-workers are talking about me, wrap myself in faith. Are y'all still out there? Not only that, the Hebrew writer says it's the down payment of the things that you desire. I want to go to heaven. I don't know about you. I want to wake up one morning and see those pearly gates, walk on those golden streets, see the walls of Jasper. Yes. Yes. Amen. I want to rest with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, Elijah, Elisha. I just want to be up there with the rest of y'all. Amen. Amen. I don't know about you. So faith is the down payment of those things that I desire. Those are the things that I want. You know, I might not get to the rest of this sermon, but I tell you what, one thing for sure, you're going to know what faith is. This might be a part two, I don't know. Y'all done got me all excited. You know, that's the object of our faith, or the definition of our faith. What is the substance of faith? You know, it's just as important to the Christian faith to know why you believe as it is to know what you believe. Yes. I'm going to say that again. It's just as important to the Christian faith to know why you believe as it is to know what you believe. Yes. See, a preacher was trying to talk to one fellow. He said, ask him, what do you believe? Well, I believe what my church believes. Well, what does your church believe? They believe what I believe. Preacher got a little frustrated and said, well, what do you and your church believe? Well, we believe the same thing. You ever ran across anybody like that? Amen. So it's just as important to know why you believe as it is to know what you believe. You see, some folk, they can tell you, right, we the one true church. Why? You know, I know what you believe, but why do you believe that? Amen. That's what my church believes. That's what my church teaches. That's what the preacher teaches. Why does the preacher teach that? It's just as important to know why you believe it as it is to know what you believe. You can't just know something and have knowledge. You need to know why you believe it. That's why God said over in Jeremiah 31 and 31, no longer will every man ask his brother, do you believe in God? I will pour my belief or my spirit into their heart so that each man will have their own belief system, that each one will be accountable for their own knowledge about God and know why they believe in God and know what they believe in God. So it's not asking the preacher or asking the church or believing what the church believes. You need to know why you believe what you believe. Otherwise, your faith is just floating alone. And whatever comes along, your faith will jump on it. Amen, if you can. Because you don't know why you believe it. And that's why some of us come into the church and we get all mad and angry because we hear something that we have never heard before. And we don't know why we believe what we believe, but we know that that's what we believe and that's not what they are saying. So we need to figure it out. Why do we believe it? You need to know what the object of your faith is. You know, any definition of faith is incomplete without considering the object. You got to know who you believe in. You just can't say, I believe in faith, because faith alone is not good enough. I have faith. And you hear folks say it all the time, I have faith. Well, why do you have faith? It's not blind faith. We walk by faith and not by sight, but we are not blind. Oh, y'all looking at me mighty strange. So any definition of faith is incomplete without considering the object. In contrast to countless faith, you need to know who you believe in. The relationship between faith and Jesus Christ is indispensable. If you don't believe in Jesus Christ, your faith doesn't mean anything, because the object of your faith may be in you. And you get up every morning, you feel like when you get up in the morning and you put on your clothes and you go to your job, it was you who got you the job. It was you who got you the car. It was you who got you the bed to sleep in. It was you who put the food on the table. And some of us come home and have arguments with our spouse over the fact, I'm working hard to put food on this table. Amen. I'm the man of this house. Or it might be I'm the woman of this house. Amen. Amen. That's because you got all that faith in you. Not realizing that it wasn't you who put the food on the table, but it was God who put the food on the table. It was God who gave the table to you. It was God who woke you up, gave you a right mind to go to work. Amen. It was God who gave you the sense to write your name on the check so you could deposit it in the bank or to make the electronic bank deposit or however you did it. It was God who gave you that and not you. So if your object or your faith is you, then you might be in trouble. Y'all got time for school? Acts chapter 16 and verse number 31, the Bible says, and they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. And all of the house, the word their own is epi, and it suggests resting on a foundation. The Bible says that in Acts they were told to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved and your house shall be saved. And the Greek preposition there is epi, and epi means up on, and it simply means that you're resting on a foundation. So my faith is on Jesus Christ. My resting is on Jesus Christ. I don't stand without Jesus Christ being there under me. I've got to have Jesus as my foundation. That's the object of my faith. Because if I rest on my own feeble legs, you know, there are times when I sit down. Somebody else say amen. There are times when I sit down now. I sit down and I get up, and my getting up ain't as good as my sitting down no more. I sit down and I have to, and then after I finally get up, I kind of, and I got to walk it out because it ain't like it used to be. And them legs, sometimes they like, and I have to just stand there for a little while and let them get there, you know, but the foundation is sure. The legs may not be strong, but the foundation that I'm standing on, and even if I fall, the foundation is still strong. You know, I don't have it all within me, but if I'm counting on my legs and I'm counting on my strength and I'm counting on me doing what I need to do, sometimes I fall down, but I'm glad the foundation is there to catch me. Say amen. You know, when I worked out in the refinery, there were times when I would have to climb to go and see something and find something in order to make sure that it was the way that it read on the drawing. And if it wasn't the same, then I had to do some change in it. And you know, I never had a problem with heights. I've traveled, the furthest I've ever climbed on a vessel was 168 feet in the air. And I didn't have any problem with going up. I didn't even have any problem with falling. It's that sudden stop when I fall that I worry about. It's what I'm going to hit when I, you know, because coming down, I might enjoy it. If there's not something soft that'll catch me, that bothers me. Somebody will say amen. If you don't have the right foundation, it will crumble you and break you. But when you fall in the bosom of Jesus, resting in his bosom, doesn't matter how far the fall is. Doesn't matter about the sudden stop. Because you're cushioned and you're caught in the comfort and the care of the Lord. Somebody ought to help me this morning. Amen. It don't matter how far you fall. Doesn't matter if the object of your faith is the foundation of Jesus Christ, and that's who you got your eye on. Somebody need to help me this morning. I don't know. You know, in Acts chapter 20 and verse number 21, the Bible says, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greek, repenting toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. The word is not aced anymore, but it's in. And in is another preposition that's used there. And the preposition simply means to have accommodation, and it connotes the fact of a place of security and an anchor. You know, when you're abiding in the house, you feel safe and secure. It gives you the idea of a boat going out and coming back in and having a safe anchor at the harbor. That's what it's saying here. It's saying simply testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. That's your anchor. That will keep you safe. Abide in him. Amen. The Bible says, he is the vine and we are the branches. You know, two men were caught on a severe rapid. And all of a sudden they begin to go down toward the cliff where the rapid was. And folks standing on the side seen them, and they threw a rope out. One of the men caught the rope and was pulled to shore and was safe. The other one grabbed on to what he thought was a more secure anchor, and it was a floating log that was coming by. He grabbed on, and he and the log went off the cliff, and they were never seen again. That's what we need to do. We need to anchor on to God, because sometimes we grab on to stuff that's just going to take us afloat, and it's going to cause our destruction and our ruin. Some of us hanging on to all of our education. Some of us are hanging on to the fact that we have the ability to do a great job on something. Some of us are hanging on to the fact that we have a job. Amen? But you know, I remember a while back, there was a computer company that my sister worked for in Baton Rouge, and I can't remember the name right now, but she was the manager. And she came to work. She called me and said, I don't know what to do. I'm like, what do you mean you don't know what to do? My key don't work in the door, and the building is empty. They packed up overnight, didn't tell her, didn't tell nobody, and just left. Oh, I know who it was. It was Compaq. Y'all remember Compaq? Some of y'all do. Compaq Computer Company was growing. They were doing well. And all of a sudden, they just shut down all over the country. All in one night. And they did the exact same thing everywhere. Went out of business. Didn't tell nobody. She was counting on the fact that she had a job. The manager of the job. And they didn't inform her that they were closing down. Amen, if you can. So you need to put your trust in God and don't anchor yourself on stuff that could fade away.
Yes.
No trust in folk who will fade away. Amen.
Amen.
Folk can't trust folk that can't be trusted. Amen. Another way of looking at this great pillar of faith is faith in Christ is like a spear. It's like an area. It's like a territory. It's like a world. By faith we live. Romans chapter 1 and verse number 17. I'm coming to an end. Amen. And by faith we stand. Everything that we do stands on our faith. By faith we walk. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse number 7. Faith, by faith we fight the good fight.
Yeah. Yeah.
We do what we do by faith.
Yeah.
We overcome by faith.
Yeah.
We are justified by faith. By faith we are made the children of God.
Yeah.
Amen. We're sanctified by faith.
Yeah.
We have access by faith. Faith purifies our hearts. Amen? And you need to be unmovable. Amen?
Yes,
unmovable. Not standing, not moving, persistent, not moving from one place to another, metaphorically, to be firm and to be persistent. Being unmovable has the same connotation of the song says, I shall not be moved, I shall not be, I shall not be moved. Sometimes it refers to folk on the pews. Amen. I shall not be moved, I shall not be moved, I will not be moved, I cannot be moved. Amen. Or it has to do with the kind of emotional deadness a person may come to in church and can't be moved. They can't be moved by worship. They can't be moved by the sermon. They can't be moved by the invitation to salvation. I shall not be moved. I will not be moved. I cannot be moved. There's a lot of unmoving going on in the church. Say amen if you can. Worship can't move you. Can't move off the pew. That's my chair. Visitors come and you will not move. Get mad if somebody get to your seat before you get to it. I will not be moved. I shall not be moved. I cannot be moved. Amen. To be unmoving means that nothing can move us out of our job. Nothing can move us from our assignment that the Lord has given us. The believer who is unmovable is not one that can change, can be changed by the winds of the world. Amen. But one cannot be persistent to quit, throw in the towel, move from area of service. And, you know, when you can't be moved, Paul said, being unmovable. Amen. By faith, I'm unmovable because I have that anchor in Jesus Christ. The winds can come. The winds may blow. I'm not moving because I'm just like that red tree or the cedars of Lebanon. I'm not going to be moved because I am anchored in the Lord.
Yes.
You know, the Cedars of Lebanon has a unique thing, and I probably told you before, but let me tell it to you again. The cedars over in Lebanon grow up to be like those great red trees out in California, and what they do is they go down, their roots go down into the ground, and they go so deep. And then they began to turn inwardly. Y'all listen to me. And when they get turned inwardly, they kind of mingle themselves and tie themselves in a knot around a rock. The Rock of Ages. And as they tie themselves around the Rock of Ages, they wrap themselves and they mingle themselves so that nothing can move them. They will not be moved. The winds may come. The rains may come. But because they are anchored in the Lord, because they're anchored on the rock, it doesn't matter what comes against them. It doesn't matter how hard the difficulty is. They cannot be moved.
Yes. Yes.
Folk in the church may start acting a fool. The preacher may start acting a fool. The deacons may act a fool. The elders may act a fool. The sisters may act a fool. The brothers.
Yeah.
But because I'm anchored in the Lord,
yeah,
y'all can go on and do whatever you want to do. I ain't going nowhere because I'm tied to the Lord and I shall not be moved. I ain't going nowhere. Can't nobody make me so mad that I don't want to be here no more. Can't nobody get under my skin to the point where I won't be here anymore. Because I'm wrapped around the rock. I'm wrapped around the rock. Rock. The Rock of Ages. Ain't nobody can make me go nowhere because I got Jesus. And long as the Lord is with me, y'all can do whatever y'all want to do. I suggest to you, tie yourself around the rock. Wrap yourself around the rock. Stop being unmoved to the point where you don't want to do nothing in the church. I'm just not feeling it anymore. I don't feel good there anymore. That's because your object is tied up in you. You looking at you and stop looking at you and start looking at Jesus. And Jesus is moving on. Jesus is moving. Jesus is going. Jesus wants you to go with Jesus. But if you all wrapped up in you, everything gonna make you feel like you don't want to be a part anymore. And because your object is not Jesus, your faith is not in Jesus, your faith is in your feelings, you're going to always be frustrated.
Amen.
Amen. You're going to always be fickle.
Yes.
You're going to always find yourself not functioning for the Lord.
Amen.
Are you still here?
Yeah.
You're talking about faith.
Yeah.
Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. The object of my faith is Jesus. I'm stopped looking at folk and start looking at the Savior. And when I look at the Savior, doesn't nothing sadden me. Doesn't nothing sedate me. Doesn't nothing stop me. Amen. I keep on going because I love the Lord. And because I love the Lord, I can be moved to do what the Lord wants me to do. I will never move away from the Lord, but I will always stay with Jesus.
Yes.
If you're here this morning and you feel like you've been moving and drifting and you grabbed onto the wrong foundation, I suggest to you that you come back and grab Jesus. I suggest that you turn around, repent, come back to the Lord. You've heard his word. You believe it. Confess Jesus Christ to be the Son of God.
Yes.
That confession brought death to Jesus, but it'll bring life to you. It'll get your faith back in the right place. It'll get your priorities right. It'll help you to stop looking all around you, seeing all the trouble that you see. And you will start focusing on God and realize that with Jesus, he gives you the peace that surpasses all understanding. And all the rest of that stuff just pass on by. You can be just because you just leave it up to God. Amen. Leave it up to God. I know some of y'all worrying about folk that have done you something and you weren't figuring out and spent all this time trying to figure out how you're going to get them back. Here's how you get them back. Just leave it up to the Lord.
Amen.
Well, there's folk who done Ferguson night wrong. Just leave it up to the Lord.
Amen.
There are folks who we can't stand when we see them in the supermarket. Just leave it up to the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know what I'm going to say to them when I get to them. Just leave it up to the Lord.
Amen.
If I see them, I don't know what I'm going to say to them. Just leave it up to the Lord. The Lord will take care of it. Let the Lord move your lips. Because if you open your mouth and the Lord ain't in there, there ain't no telling what might come out. Leave it up to the Lord. Don't you say nothing. Let God open your mouth. If God decides to do like he did with the Daniel and the lion, then shut those lions' mouth. Keep your mouth shut. Say amen if you can. I'm just saying, now, if you're here and those things are going on in your life, you need to get it right with God. This is the time that you need to do that. And we're going to sing the song of invitation. Brother Joe is ready. He's waiting for me to move. And let us stand.
Would you be free from your burdens of sin?